Hi, this is Hugh Syme, and you're listening to the legendary Sonic Perspective.
Hi everyone, and welcome to another Sonic Perspectives interview. I'm your host Rodrigo Altaf, and today I have the honor of talking to the creator of some of the most iconic album covers of prog and metal, Mr. Hugh Syme. Hugh, thank you for joining us tonight.
It's my pleasure, man, really.
There's a lot of ground to cover, but let's start at the beginning. Tell us about your musical upbringing and also how you got started as a graphic designer and as a musician.
Well, music was just part of my family. My aunt was a concert pianist, my father played violin, and my mother forced me to practice, and I respect her, and I'm forever grateful for her pushing me, even though at the time I thought she was wicked for doing so. I get it now, and you know, and playing music was a joy for me, and you know, and we all discovered the Beatles and everybody that sort of shaped our futures as far as, you know, rock and pop music is concerned. And just around the time that my family was living in Canada, my father, who was with the pulp and paper industry, moved the family to England. So I was on the other side of the British invasion. And shortly after, my father bought me a set of drums. And so I got heavily into sort of researching and discovering music. And then along came the piano players who made piano and keyboard players who made, you know, keyboards cool, like Emerson and Wakeman, and even the Beatles producer made piano cool, and Elton John and so on. So, you know, I followed my instincts, just, you know, was never thinking in terms of being in a band, but went through fine arts at university. And when I left, I did a recording session, which happened to be produced by Ian Thomas. And Ian Thomas was on the same label as Rush, and he asked me to join his band. I thought he was nuts for doing so, but I did so, and I recorded 7 albums with him, and was asked to do the album covers for Rush at the very, very beginning.
So. Right. Yeah, yeah. Let's talk about Ian Thomas' band for a second, because you collaborated with him for 7 years. Do you think this could have lasted a little bit longer, or it lasted what it had to last?
It was a great collaboration. I mean, I enjoyed being, you know, in his band. It taught me a great deal about performance, singing, and just working with other band members. And these guys were great players and great singers. You know, we took a break around the early part of the 80s, and we treated it as a break. But at that point, I'd already done 3 or 4 Rush covers and Max Webster, and I had done a couple of covers for the band that I was in, Ian Thomas's band. Mm-hmm. And then Bob Ezrin came back from having done The Wall, and he invited me to do a cover for a local Toronto band called The Kings, and sent me down to L.A. to deliver the album. That began my guarded love affair with Los Angeles. And mm-hmm. and very shortly thereafter, I was invited to stay down there. My 6 weeks, which was supposed to be just painting for Quiet Riot and Whitesnake at the time, that 6 weeks turned into 16 years. So,
oh wow!
It was the right time. Again, dumb luck, you know, just dumb luck and hard work, you know.
Right, right.
But as far as Ian's concerned, you know, brilliant singer, brilliant songwriter, and yes, I suppose if we'd all kind of reconnected again, we could have continued on. Mm-hmm. But he did start going into a different direction, formed another band called The Boomers, also a brilliant band and great players. And we, you know, quietly went our separate ways, which was fine. I continued to do album covers for The Boomers.
Okay.
So we stayed in touch.
Right. And I know you got invited to work with Rush on Caress of Steel. Tell us how that invitation came about, and what was the process to create that cover in particular?
The process was pencil. Graphite. I was very enamored at that time, and still am. I really respect MC Escher the lithographer and draftsman.
Yeah.
And I had never seen a pencil drawing on an album cover, so I thought this was a good time to stretch, you know, to exercise that particular look. Ray Daniels, who was the brilliant manager for the band Rush and happened to be the head of the label and management for Ian Thomas Band, invited me into his office to say that Rush had noticed some covers I'd been doing for Max Webster, also another amazing band with Kim Mitchell on guitar.
Yeah.
I had done some covers for them and my band, and Rush invited me. And I look back with, you know, some perspective now that I was young and presumptuous to think that because this band wasn't Genesis or Supertramp, you know, I would give them a shot, you know, and 44 years later, I'm still their art director. So I'm glad I did. You know, I'm really glad. And they were a wonderful band. We'll get into that, but they were just the right band. We were the right fit, that's for sure.
Right, for sure, yeah. One particular favorite of mine when it comes to Rush is the Grace Under Pressure cover. There's the airplane wing at the top. Was that intended to represent the KAL Flight 007, or...?
I noticed that in your earlier sort of question to me. Are you sure the wing you're referring to isn't on the glider cover for Ian Thomas? Because the Grace Under Pressure cover doesn't a wing. So I'm thinking maybe what you're thinking about is the glider cover from the Ian Thomas Band.
Oh, maybe.
And no, it wasn't to represent that fateful flight. No, it was just the fact that at the time, I felt the Ian Thomas Band really needed to consider a different name because we had been taken on by Chrysalis and Atlantic in the U.S. You know, it was a real big deal for a Canadian artist to get the traction they need, you know, outside of Canada. Canada represented 88% of the North American market. The U.S. was the most sought-after area. So we would go out and, you know, we would open up for the Beach Boys or Robert Palmer or Roxy Music, Billy Joel. It was a good ride, but we'd also come back to the humbling realization that we had to survive. So we'd come back and play the same clubs that Rush did when they were coming up back in Toronto. So that was another reason we all probably decided to take that break we referred to earlier. But I'd always felt that Ian Thomas's band should have been called Steely Dan or Split Ends, you know, all the names that were coming out at the time, the Babies, Split Ends, Steely Dan.
Right.
You know, that's why we sort of experimented with the glider concept.
Oh, right, yeah. No, when I mean the wing, there's a detail there that looks like a broken wing of a plane on the Grace Under Pressure cover, but, you know, point taken, yeah.
Interesting. A lot of people think of those as rusting razor blades, and then I was accused, you know, erroneously by some know-it-all art critic out in L.A. You know, in the early 80s, I saw a Los Angeles Times review of that painting, and I was grateful for the acknowledgement, but the fellow who did the review, I forget his name, but immediately presumed that because of the content of the painting and the fact that there were three kind of blades coming at you. And I didn't think of them as razor blades. I just thought of them as, you know, texture and elements, you know, not specific. But he accused me of being heavily into cocaine to have produced a painting like that. So I was always amused by his presumption.
Right. Well, it's a trippy cover, but I wouldn't go as far as saying that you're under the influence of cocaine when you did that. No, for sure not.
No. Glad to hear it. Yeah.
And about the moving pictures cover, was it difficult to get a permit to photograph at the steps of the Parliament Building in Toronto? Or
surprisingly not. I saw the building. I thought, wow, three arches, three band members, and you know, every division between the arches was three pillars. You know, we early on in the band's career, we definitely used the number three as a graphic device.
Yeah.
Throughout their whole career. And so when I saw the building, I thought, oh, this is perfect. So I went and checked with City Hall and with the Queens Park people, that's actually at Queen's Park, that building.
Yeah.
And they were very receptive and very supportive of the arts and gave us the entire Sunday to work. So it was great.
I live here in Toronto, and in my morning commute, I go by Queen's Park, the station. Every time I hear it, this is Queen's Park Station, you know, I think, you know, it's here. Here's what that cover is made. So it left a mark on me for sure.
Well, you know, and I have to be candid and say that, you know, one of my inspirations to get into the very free and indulgent world of art in the music industry. I mean, I could have easily gone on and been sort of an illustrator in the commercial art realm. And I do more of that now because what we once knew as the burgeoning music business, we're all feeding off the carcass of that now because it's just not the same. Ever since Napster and iTunes and so on, it's a very different industry. But having the latitude that the music business and the record cover frame of reference afforded, you know, designers like Storm Thorgerson and Hypnosis and so on, who are very influential in terms of my saying, yeah, that's what I want to do for a living. You know, I realized that when Pink Floyd did the Animals cover with the power station in London, I thought, well, there's a landmark. So it wasn't lost on me that Queen's Park would also be a potentially legendary landmark for Rush.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And how much of the process is you creating the cover and how much is the artist process? I mean, like if there's a disagreement between Getty, Alex and Neil, for example, and you, how is that solved? How was that solved when you did those covers?
Well, early on the band, I think the band was just too busy and maybe even a little bit intimidated to presume that they should be involved in the art. I don't think they really understood the process. Later on in our career, Neil and I clicked beautifully and we developed a great sense of collaboration where I would review the lyrics, review the theme or the arc of the album's theme. And, you know, Neil was never one, you know, one of the dreaded things that art directors in this industry encounter is a band that says, you know what, we've got a great idea for our next album cover. And I'm thinking they never went there. You know, they never suggested anything to me. So the freedom they afforded me was a gift. And I was forever grateful for that. When I heard the title Moving Pictures, for example, I thought, yeah, we got to have guys moving pictures. You know, I mean, that was the beginning of our glib and, you know, somewhat banal sense of humor, but it also permeated through their whole career. I mean, they were self-effacing, the Three Stooges. You know, I mean, I don't have to say more.
Yeah.
You know, these guys, as serious as they were as musicians and as precise and dedicated as they were, they understood levity and self the concept of being self-effacing. So, that was another piece of luxury that I had, was that I could be whimsical without being shot down because it wasn't serioso enough, you know. Mm-hmm.
I see. And nowadays, how is the process to come up with new ideas? I mean, how quickly do you settle on an idea? And does that depend on the artist, or what's your process like?
I just realized that part of your last question was, how do we settle differences?
Yeah.
In the case of Rush, there were never any. The only one instances where we didn't even come to blows. We just, you know, when I described the original idea for Power Windows, I said, we're going to have a lone character in a room by himself, controlling the world with his remote control from an old TV, like a vintage TV channel changer. And they said, that's great. I said, we could probably feature the Marshall McLuhan of you know, the media. The medium is the message. That was his famous kind of acknowledgement to pop culture that, you know, the TV was, in fact, our kind of window to the world. Everybody's living room relied on TV. Nowadays, of course, it's smartphones and iPhones and so on.
Yeah.
But at the time, I thought, well, maybe we'll feature some TVs, maybe some old deco TVs. But when I finished the painting, I liked the lone empty room, and I thought it was finished. And Getty came up to me and said, you know what, that TV thing, I really like that. I said, yeah, but it's better the way it is. And he said, no, I disagree. So,
right.
So when he said that, I thought, all right, well, let's, before we go there, I realize that I have to regesso my canvas and I have to introduce those painting, those televisions into my painting. Are you sure you want to do this? He said, yes. And to this day, I credit him with the wisdom of having enforced that feature to the cover, because I think it really helps the cover
be what it is,
you know?
Mm-hmm. And it was used, like the TV motif, it was used on the stage a lot. It was used up to the Clockwork Angels, I think, tour, where we had this massive, like vintage TV in the backdrop and so on, right?
Yeah. You never know going in just what you're developing. When I created the Starman for 2112, I didn't have a clue that would end up being their brand. You do these things as part of your creative process, but you don't necessarily contrive that it's going to be the next Coca-Cola logo or Playboy bunny, you know. And then in that case, it was their logo.
Yeah. No, I compared the Starman to the tongue, the lips and the tongue of Rolling Stones. You know, that's how iconic it was for Rush fans, of course.
Yeah. Great. Well, that's a compliment. Thank you.
No worries. And have you ever come to reject any project due to differences with the artist or the band? Or
almost. There was one band that came to me with a concept. The band was called Hurricane. And they're title was Slave to the Thrill, and I thought, well, that's an interesting title, so what do you have in mind? And they told me, they sort of expressed some desire to put a woman in some kind of, you know, bondage, bear trap kind of device, and I thought, that's pretty sexist, and I thought, no, that's not for me. Even though I had done Whitesnake's, I'd done the Scorpions, Skin Deep with all the Scorpions and the woman. Mm-hmm. And I had done Hooked by Great White, and I'd also done a moderately naughty cover for Warrant called Cherry Pie. Those were the only kind of, you know, lightly sexist things that I'd ever done. But this one was, I felt challenged by Hurricane. I thought, well, we're looking at least over the top in the school of Ridley Scott and the design that went into the movie Blade Runner. I thought, well, let's make this a serious statement. If we're going to do it, let's not be just gratuitously sexist. Let's make it sculpture and make it fun and make it dramatic. And that's why I did the cover. I don't feature it in my book a lot because it is a little controversial, but yeah, that's the one I almost passed on.
Right. And do you prefer to work on album covers and other artworks, or do you prefer creating images for the commercial world as you do right now?
Oh, well, I do it now because it's part of what, you know, like I said earlier, we're feeding off the carcass of what was once the music business. So, you know, with three daughters in university and with this thing we call survival, you know, we have to be nimble enough to kind of adapt. And I've been fortunate even in that regard, because I work with some pretty hip companies like Samuel Adams Beer, and a lot of pharmaceutical art directors are not just taking photographs of pills anymore. They're doing much more metaphorical and interesting images. So when I do delve into the commercial, it's usually people that call upon me. Oddly enough, and again, gratefully, I see a lot of art directors who come to me from the commercial realm saying, I'm a huge Rush fan, or I've been looking forward to working with you.
Wow, that's pretty cool. Mm.
So there's a nice, you know, there's a cross-pollination of respect for imagery, you know, and these people are, you know, just because you're working as an art director in an ad agency doesn't mean you don't love pop music, pop culture, and rock music. So in that respect, it's been a nice marriage. Do I prefer commercial? Probably not. You know, the freedom I'm afforded by my continuing relationship with two major clients that still love the smell of paper and the feel, you know, the smell of ink and the feel of paper. Mm-hmm. That would be Dream Theater and Rush. They still do pretty elaborate and pretty involved packaging, which we all enjoy doing. So,
Sure.
Well, while that may not be the mainstay of my career, it's still something I welcome from time to time.
I see.
The freedom is the real seductive part of doing record covers, because it is, you know, they give you a title, and then I tell them I'll see you in 6 weeks, you know? And then I get to go and work whatever and do what I need to do.
Right. And sometimes you do the covers like already knowing the lyrics and some of the music at least, and sometimes it's just the album title, right?
That is correct. Yeah. In some instances, the band isn't finished recording. A lot of times, again, Rush is a good example. Neil might have lyrics prepared. There may be no melody for the lyrics because Geddy and Alex have yet to kind of, you know, structure the song, but Neil already knows what his lyric might be. So he'll share those with me early in the game. And they're still rehearsing. They're still getting ready to go in and record. But if I get a title like Signals or Counterparts or Moving Pictures or Permanent Waves, all of which, again, spoiled me rotten because Neil was a real wordsmith. It is. In fact, to this day, he's an author and a wordsmith. And for him to come to me with these great titles as a starting point for any graphic designer, it was a gift. You know, we had a lot of fun with titles from that particular lyricist.
Mm-hmm. I like how you speak of Rush in the present. It saddens me that they're like done, at least semi-officially done, but I like how you refer to them in the present, man. I wish there was some more gas in that tank, but apparently there isn't, right?
Well, I think the gas predominantly is Geddy and Alex. I think, you know, Neil being a father and being committed to his family, you know, and I think publicly we all know that Alex has a bit of arthritis and, you know, has some tendonitis. You know, they wanted to go out on top, and rightly so. I think Geddy and Alex will probably continue doing something. I have a hard time believing they would try to do a Led Zeppelin with somebody else playing drums. You know, it just wouldn't be right.
Yeah.
But I speak of them in the present because, well, I thought they had retired, and that was a nice 42-year run. You know, what's next? Well, the answer to that question is that they started doing 40th anniversary box sets, which celebrate 2112 and A Farewell to Kings and Hemispheres. The next one out of the gate will be Permanent Waves. But those packages, you know, are more indulgent, more extravagant, more elaborate than anything I ever did for a studio album. So for me, as a designer and an art director and an illustrator, it's the gift that keeps on giving. This band, much like the Beatles, I mean, two of the Beatles are gone. You know, they're just not with us anymore.
Yeah.
But we never stopped thinking about the Beatles as anything but a living entity. You know, so I speak of Rush in the present because they are. You know, they are in the present. They, for any Rush fan, they will always be with us, you know?
Yeah. No, same here. How do you personally deal with living in the limelight? Has it been a positive experience for you? I mean, do you have any crazy Rush fan experiences to share, or people chasing you down the street, or?
No. Well, first of all, I've been pretty private all my life, and not by design. You know, I've just been busy. You know, and what I do isn't on stage. You know, what I do is in the privacy of my studios. Apart from being recognizable as a name, and I didn't realize early in my kind of youthful stupidity that by doing an album cover for, you know, an Aerosmith that sells 16 million records, that maybe my name might get noticed. You know, I didn't really think about that until later in my career. I thought, well, you know what, there's something to be said for publishing that many units of my artwork and having that much free spin, that much free promotion, you know. So I later became a little bit more savvy to the fact that what I do reached a lot of people and that people might know my name, but they don't know me. And limelight, in the case of Rush, limelight would mean that, yes, Geddy would have to dodge and Alex might have to dodge and Neil may have to dodge the well-meaning autograph seekers, but I never had any of that. And I'm glad of it because I didn't need it and I don't need it. So.
Right. Sure. And you're one of the few people who played on a Rush album. Aside from you, I think only the first drummer, right? John Rutsey and Ben Mink. How did they ask you to do that?
Well, before internet, email, were, you know, most of my relationships with Mike Portnoy and John Petrucci have been fairly remote. It's a lot of telephone calls and a lot of emails. Even Neil and I ended up kind of seeing each other less and less. It was more through faxing. In the early days, he would fax me his lyrics, his beautifully handwritten lyrics, which were everybody knows about. And I got copies of those. And so it became more and more of a faceless experience. In the initial days, I was flown to meet Tesla or meet Megadeth or meet Iron Maiden in London. I always had to go and meet the bands, you know. One of my favorite trips, of course, was to meet Jimmy Page when David Coverdale and Jimmy did their ill-fated merge project. But I was pleased, of course, to go and meet legendary and wonderfully humble Jimmy, you know.
That was Coverdale Page,
yeah, Coverdale,
right? Yeah.
The days of going to, you know, Le Studio in the north of Montreal and hanging with the band, having dinner with the band, even jamming with the band, which was a real treat, you know, those days are gone, you know. But when I would go up to Montreal and stay with them for a week or so, you know, it was Terry Brown who said, you know, you should play something on this. And the first time I did that was very early on in their career. And I did go to the studio to talk album cover. And that's when I did the opening for 2112 on synthesizer. And then Geddy wanted me to play some keyboards on his beautiful and intimate, you know, sort of rarely intimate sort of and exposed track called Tears. So I think it really was more Terry saying, we should have Hugh do this. And then the band saying, sure, why not, you know. But I've always been grateful for Terry's wisdom, you know.
Right. So that was sort of like a serendipity sort of thing. You just were there and then you played. Because the last collaboration was on Witch Hunt. And I wonder why it never happened again.
Well, in the case of Witch Hunt, that was around the same. It was at the same studio I did Different Strings, which was Moran Heights, which was north of Montreal, beautiful place where everybody from the Bee Gees to the Police, everybody recorded there. It's a fantastic facility. It wasn't long after that, first of all, I went to L.A., which put me at arm's length from the band. And that's when the digital era began and email and different modes of communication became available to us. Having to fly and be face-to-face with your clients or your friends or your musician clients was less and less necessary. So that probably answers your question. Why was the last time? What was the last time I was in the studio with those guys? That's the first fair answer. And the other answer would be that Geddy was slowly kind of getting his feet wet in the shallow end of this thing called keyboards. And he slowly kind of delved into that area. You know, I know he always was intrigued with piano. He would come to my place and I would play pieces for him. And he was very complimentary and even went so far to say, you know, I hate you. A huge compliment. But I think a part of his, you know, his journey into keyboards, he kept it minimal. He kept it melodic. I will say to Geddy's credit that he did a brilliant job of developing melodic keyboard and manageable keyboard parts that worked for his skill set.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, yeah. One thing I'm curious about is the different logos on the album covers. Were they created as part of the artwork? I mean, was there a discussion of now we want to be this type of band, so this logo is more applicable and so on?
That's actually almost a misnomer. The fact that you say logo speaks to something that we actually discussed this very, very early on with Aerosmith, a band called Chicago, which had a constantly reinterpreted logo, Van Halen. A lot of bands had logos, and those logos would appear every Megadeth. You know, they would always appear album after album. Mm-hmm. It became a necessary part of their album. I sort of challenged the band. I said, are you progressive? Yes. Are you progressive musically? Yeah, well, we hope so. Can we be progressive graphically so that when we do a conceptual cover, do we want to overpower that cover with a really intrusive and overbearing logo that's constantly kind of the constant or the brand, you know? or do we want to be bravely minimal and let the art speak for itself, and maybe let the name be a little bit more graphically simple and clean? And they erred towards the latter. And again, I'm grateful that they did. I said, you know, there's a confidence. Look at the So album by Peter Gabriel. Look at so many albums by bands like that that didn't need to kind of hit you in the face with a logo. And early in our relationship, they adhered to that. Or they cottoned on to that realization that they didn't have to shout at you. Yeah. So, and from my standpoint as a self-serving art director, I love the fact that the art got to speak for itself, and the band name was informative, communicative, but not necessarily intrusive. Yeah, or occupying a third of my cover.
Right.
And I say my cover.
Right. Fair enough. And what's behind the decision to revise the art of the three Rush reissues so far? And are the band members already also involved with these revisions?
You're talking about the box sets?
Yeah, the box sets. The Hemispheres, the Permanent Waves, and I think Farewell to Kings, right? And 2112.
A lot of times with anything that's kind of commemorative or retrospective and so on, the band looks at that as kind of catalog, you know. And in the case of the box sets, it's much more important in from the standpoint of the demands that I make of myself. It's not just the band expecting what I hope to be a good end result. But every time I work with Rush, I sort of demand that same attention to detail from myself, because we're only as good as our last effort. So when we started doing the box sets, one of the luxuries that I didn't have back in the album cover days, if you had a sleeve with a back and a front, or maybe a gatefold with a back, front, and inner spread, that's it. Mm-hmm. Your real estate was done. But now we're doing, you know, 40-page booklets, which allow me to illustrate every lyric and to refamiliarize myself with lyrics from the 70s, some of which I, in fairness, you know, in truth, I've never really delved into and really become intimate with. But when I reread those lyrics, I come to realize, or I get to harvest imagery from Neil's words. And I take note of the most poignant, hopefully the most poignant or pivotal lyric in a given song, and hopefully breathe life into that with imagery. So again, it's indulgent, it's extravagant, and it's a second chance to revisit those projects in a much more expanded fashion than we ever had the ability to do back in the 70s. But the band is not really involved, no.
I see. And I saw an interview where you mentioned that Hemispheres is a cover you'd like to redo, if possible, with today's technology. What would you change about it? I mean, and any other album cover from your whole catalog? Would you have a second chance? Or
Everybody, including Neil and, you know, everybody else, you know, there are times that I've talked to Neil and he said, yeah, I would have probably liked to play that differently, or I could probably play that better today. We grow, you know, we develop our style and our skills as we do, as we delve into what we do. I liken Hemispheres to, you know, one of the other iconic covers. I like to think Hemispheres has staying power and impact, just as the Blind Faith cover with the young girl and the kind of the chromium Chevy. It looks like an airplane. I think it's a Chevy hood ornament, but it's a controversial cover. It's technically pretty awful, you know, the way they cut around her hair. Mm-hmm. I think it was a Hypnosis cover, but, you know, it was very early days, and the whole idea of compositing people and things from different elements into a final frame of reference, you know, that became very much a Hypnosis phenomenon. And also is a strong component of what I do. I like to build improbable realities of disparate components and elements. But in the case of Hemispheres, if you look at it from the standpoint of compositing and seamless retouching and so on, it falls far short of what I would do today. So that's all I meant. You know, technically we grow, and the band has to look back at handlebar mustaches and big billowing blouses.
Kimonos.
Kimonos, you know. Yeah. So we all do things that at the time feel right, you know. So there's never any regret, but there's certainly, one would hope, some evolution.
Right. Makes sense. And changing the subject a little bit, what was it like working with Iron Maiden, and what kind of information did they give you for the X Factor cover?
No information whatsoever. They gave me a title.
Oh, wow.
I was surprised. You know, I was living in the U.S. at the time, and they were in London recording. And, you know, as I developed ideas and so on, I would send them to them. And back then, there was no email. So I would download my work in progress to what was then known as a SideQuest disc, which was like a big cumbersome disc that held a big 200 megabytes of data. You know, nowadays we put 60 gigabytes on a thumb drive,
yeah,
or 150 gigabytes. So back then it was like a 7-inch square box with a SideQuest disc. And I would send that counter to counter. It was like a $300 delivery from North America overnight to the band so they could see it in the morning. It was,
wow,
it was kind of like FedEx on steroids. But it got to the point where management and the band just got sick of the delay. You know, let's just do this real time. So they invited me over to London for a few weeks to work on the finish of the project. But Eddie had to be on the cover because Eddie was their, you know, Vic Rattlehead.
Yeah.
Even though Vic came long after Eddie, you know. Eddie had to be on the cover. So I sculpted and painted a maquette of Eddie and created the torture table and just brought what I thought to be the X Factor to life in the fashion that I did. The band seemed to like it. A lot of fans didn't. A lot of fans, you know, it's like, you know, if someone were to try to come along and do a Yes cover without it being Roger Dean, a lot of fans would have probably been a bit possessive about that. Same with Phil Travers from the Pink Floyd, the Moody Blues band. Phil did a lot of them, all their covers. And gratefully, Rush fans have been kind of possessive about their art director too. So if someone else tried to do what I do. So I forget the name of the illustrator from, I think it's from Ireland, who does Eddie, but you know, rightfully so.
Derek Riggs. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah, Derek. I never met him, but I have a big, great respect for his chops, his artistic prowess. And even though the band, I think at the time they used, you know, they used Megadeth as a point of reference because we had sort of developed Vic Rattlehead in a way that had never been done before in the illustration versions. And Megadeth was much more, their fans were much more forgiving, and they embraced Countdown to Extinction and the Euthanasia Project more than I think Iron Maiden was, their fans were willing to. I think, and I've heard great things and good compliments about that cover, but I've heard a lot of sort of outcries that it was sacrilegious, you know, it's just an effrontery to Derek, yeah.
I'm an Iron Maiden fan as well, and at the time I thought it was very strange. You know, it caused me discomfort or some concern at the time. But anyway, I grew to love that cover. I think it's so realistic. It was shocking to me at the time. You know, different style, and the band was changing the style as well with a different singer, different lineup. So
yeah,
but yeah, I see what you mean.
The shockingness. What's shocking about the cover? It's pretty evident. I mean, it's a pretty gruesome image. But as you say, if you become accustomed to a style and you become accustomed to the illustrative style of Derek, then somebody else dares to come along and sort of take it into a different direction. Well, to many fans' sensibilities, that's an effrontery. It's sacrilegious. You know?
Yeah.
So, you
know, yeah, I think so.
I loved meeting the band. I loved drinking with the band. I loved hanging in London. It was a great experience. They're all great guys.
Yeah, and around the same time, you did the Countdown to Extinction, you did the Euthanasia, which was very controversial as well, and you did the Get a Grip from Aerosmith. I think it was the best-selling album you ever worked on, right?
It's up there, yeah.
Mm-hmm. What was it like to develop that cover? I mean, were they as engaged, was the band as engaged as, say, Iron Maiden or Rush, for that matter, or...?
Well, I had a lot of conversations with Steve Tyler at the time, and we spoke. His original title for that album was Rag, Wings, and Heavy Iron.
Okay.
And that's not a well-known fact, but we had all kinds of ideas of doing some, you know, aeronautical, you know, rivets, the paneling on the side of a DC-10 or something. We had all kinds of ideas that played to that title, and then eventually Get a Grip was the title that I was given. And I went to a board meeting at Geffen Records on Sunset with John Kolodner and a couple of the art directors within the company. And, you know, outside art directors they're sort of looked at, you know, some people embrace you as, you know, as welcome, and some people will look at you as intruders. And in the case of a band of the stature of Aerosmith, you can be sure that the art directors within the company would really like to do the cover. Anyway, those are the moments when they really want to possess the opportunity to do a cover. And In that meeting, there were two art directors, and they were bringing their concepts to the table, and they were all good concepts. A couple of the executives said, "Yeah, we should, for Get a Grip, we should choke the chicken." And I thought, well, that's pretty funny, but, you know, what else you got, you know? So in the conversation, I said, you know, the fashionable trend of piercing nipples could be kind of funny if we did that to a cow udder. And for some reason, the room went dead silent. I thought, well, they're going to dismiss me really quickly. And very quickly, they started laughing and saying, that's the cover. And I knew that in that moment, that was at the dismay of a couple of the art directors that were in that meeting at the time. But right. It was around that time that I moved to Indiana after the earthquake in Los Angeles. And so in Indiana, I found the cow. It's a local cow in Indiana that I photographed for that cover.
Oh, okay. You're back to Indiana now, aren't you?
I am, yeah. I was in Toronto for years. I was in L.A. I went down to L.A. in the early 80s. Bob Ezrin, who produced The Wall, had just finished 22 months with Pink Floyd, and then he came back to Toronto. And he produced, you know, a local band, like a very good pop band called The Kings, and they had a big hit called Switch It to Glide back in the early 80s. I remember being at Nimbus 9 on Yorkville Avenue, or Hazelton Lanes in Yorkville, and Bob played me this album by the Pink Floyd band, and I remember hearing the album and going, yeah, I bet you that's going to be a successful album, because it was brilliant. It just sounded so good. But he played me some of The Kings, and he said, I want you to do the cover. He shipped me down to L.A. to deliver the album to Geffen's company at the time called Asylum Records. And it was then that I got bit by the L.A. bug. I was then asked to do a painting for Whitesnake and one for Quiet Riot. I was put up in a nice house with a convertible Mustang, and I thought, yeah, I could get used to this. And as I prepared to go back to Toronto, they said, where are you going? I said, no, I'm going back to my studio. I said, why? You should be here. So my 6 weeks turned into 16 years. But the earthquake and my having an eight-month-old daughter at the time shook me and my then-wife loose. And we left L.A. 3 weeks after the earthquake. And we already had a house in Indiana. So that's my first taste of Indiana. After my wife and I decided to call it quits, I went up to Toronto for a few years and realized that, you know, I didn't have to be there. I could work from anywhere. So for the price of a driveway in Toronto, I'm building a house down in Indiana.
Yeah, it's crazy at the moment. I live here. I live in St. Clair West, and it's amazing, yeah.
Oh, I know the area. St. Clair West, one of my favorite Italian restaurants is out there.
Which one?
Oh, God, it's right by Dufferin. It's just
Pizza Pace? Is that it?
No.
There's a few in the area.
There's one in particular that I've known for years, and I can't, to my shame, I can't remember what it's called.
It's all right.
Spent a lot of time out there.
Yeah, it's all right. Changing the subject a little bit, you were also a source of inspiration for the song Burning a Path from Deep Blue Something. How did that happen to become a subject of a song?
First of all, I think you mentioned that to me in one of our earlier encounters, and I can honestly say I had no... absolutely no clue that was the case. So,
okay.
And I'm not even sure you're right. And if you are, I'd love to know more about it, because I did the cover with them and I enjoyed working with the guys. Mm. You know, it was a fun project, but I can't imagine anyone wanting to make me, of all people, a subject of a song. So you'll have to expound on that maybe
right.
after this interview.
Sure.
You can send me your source material so I can...
Amused
or shocked at how this came to be.
Let me refine my search and I'll get back to you on that.
Okay. Yeah.
All right.
All right.
So how's the interaction with Dream Theater to design their cover? Did things change when Mike Portnoy left or?
No. Mike was brilliant in terms of communicating. It was made known to me, you know, in our first conversations that they grew up being big Rush fans and they liked my artwork. I was appreciative of their interest in my work. And, you know, I had been aware of Dream Theater. I'd heard their music and, you know, been appreciated. And I knew they were Berkeley graduates. And I knew that on many levels, they were technically better players than the boys in Rush. The last album where they all went and woodshedded the writing process and the recording on distance over time, that album is organic. It's melodically their most engaging I've ever heard. And it was the most emotionally honest album I've heard in a long time. So I think that's a testament to the fact that even though we all have families and wives and lives, and we can't all just go and hang out as musicians, it served them well to do that and to go into, to woodshed the album, go to a, you know, a rural place, you know, much like Rush when they went up to Moran Heights. It made a big deal of difference. Now, a lot of times, you know, Rush will work in Toronto on the guitar and the bass, and Neil will think about drums. They'll come together and they will bring the parts together sort of later in the process, as opposed to letting it develop organically. Mm-hmm. I think the results become evident in both instances. Anyways, Mike was brilliant to work with, great guy. And when he left, somebody stepped up, and that somebody was John Petrucci, and well-spoken, very clear on what he likes and doesn't like. But neither of them were dogmatic or imposed any kind of preconceptions. They just, as much as I was grateful for them as musicians and clients, they seemed equally grateful to have me working on their project. So that freedom is pretty heady stuff. You get to, you know, and yet you don't abuse that. You take that gift and you work with it. And I try to bring, just like with Rush, I try to bring my best. And, you know, we all, as professionals, we do two things. We try to please the client, but as artists, we also have to please ourselves. If
sure.
we don't grow, and if we don't look at what we do with any degree of respect, responsibility, and hopefully, you know, hopefully on some level excellence, then we failed.
Yeah, and when you say art director, it's more than just doing the album cover, right? But when it comes to Dream Theater and Rush, for example, are you also involved in the stage props or the imagery live that make reference to the album covers, or not really?
Not wittingly and not intentionally, but in both cases, if you go to a Rush concert and you go to a Dream Theater concert, my artwork is everywhere. It's the groundwork for all the imagery on the rear screen projection and on the merchandising and so on. So it becomes the tail that wags the dog, you know.
It's
that's gratifying. But do I get physically involved? Not really. No, I gave Neil some ideas on his elaborate drum set for Clockwork Angels. Had nothing to do with either of Getty's rig or Alex's rig, but we knew going in it was going to be pretty steampunk.
Right, right. I'm asking because, for example, right now on the stage, James has that microphone stand, which is, you know, sort of a replica of your album cover. You know, it's the digital hand holding the skull. So.
Yeah, and I only saw that as I started doing the tour book for the boys. You know, they had to do some rehearsal and they had to do the first few gigs to get the photography necessary, you know, the live photography necessary for the tour book. When they started sending that to me, I immediately saw how my cyborgs and my you know cyborg hand and skull became you know the nucleus for their artwork. For them to do a sculptural mic stand was pretty hip. You know, I saw it, I was amused and pleased.
It's pretty cool, yeah. And, well, Dream Theater, much like Rush, has very passionate fans, and some of the fans have become quite critical about the execution of your work. Like the Octavarium cover, for example, with the strings and balls not lining up. Self-titled cover, which was it was fixed before the album was released. How do you feel about that?
Well, I almost don't care. When someone takes the time to, and you know, God bless the guy that says the string doesn't quite match up to the trajectory of that one ball on the Newton's cradle. When I read that, or I heard somebody brought that to my attention, I thought, well, he's not wrong, but you know, does that mean he's brilliant or bored?
A little bit of both, I would say.
Well, I would think more of the latter. There's a lot of, you know, especially with social media. I mean, Dennis Miller said it beautifully. He said, never have lives less lived been so chronicled. You know, never has there been so much platform for opinion and know-it-alls and some fools and some insightful as well. But in those instances, I take it with a grain of salt. You know,
right?
I'm not offended, and like I say, I openly admit to the fact that I fucked up. That the string doesn't quite line up, but do I care? No, because I think the cover still stands on its own merit.
It does. It's one of the coolest ones of Dream Theater, for sure. For sure.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And I'm curious, where can people find and buy prints of your work with Rush, DT, and others? Is there an online store that people can refer to? Or
yeah, I wish I had it right in front of me, especially for the interview. But we just launched, you could Google it, but we just launched the artofrushgallery.com as a response to the book that I put out, which features my 40-some years with the band and having created the imagery. I've had lots of private people, you know, approach me through email saying, do you have prints and so on. So I'm currently doing, I just came from the gallery today. We're doing a gallery show in the U.S. for the Art of Rush, and also featuring a lot of my own private work. A lot of people aren't aware of the fact that as an artist, I don't just stop. When an album is finished, I don't stop being creative. I've spent my whole career creating art for my own sake and for my own sanity, you know. I enjoy the process. I enjoy creating. So, and I'm going to do a show at the List Gallery, the Brian List Gallery in Yorkville in 2020. We'll be doing a show up there. And he has sister galleries in Vancouver, Kelowna, and I believe one in New York. So, and maybe even some displays in the distillery of my artwork. We're working on that right now.
Oh, okay. Distillery District, you mean?
Yeah.
Awesome.
But it'd be artwork displayed externally. It'd be on the outside of the... It wouldn't be in galleries. It would be on the walls of the distillery. So,
okay.
I talked to one of the general managers down there about possibly doing this. It's still to be, you know, to be locked down as a done deal. But yeah, that should be fun.
Yeah.
I should get you the URL for the Art of Rush. You know what? I'm going to take a minute here while
sure.
we're talking.
Sure.
You know,
go ahead.
Keep asking me questions, but I'm going to read this off to you because we're live and we're talking, so I can't just kind of send it with an email.
No, that's okay. That's okay. Take your time if you want to search for it.
We launched the site, and it does provide my artwork as framed, limited edition, signed and numbered prints of my art for Rush. It's called Art of Rush. shop.musictoday.com/store. So that's where you can go and review art and see the difference, and it's sort of offered in different sizes because not everybody has, you know, especially in Toronto where we were discussing earlier, you know, real estate's so expensive, so not everybody has huge walls.
Yeah.
They have to be a bit more mindful of their footprint.
Exactly. Yeah. So this this discussion you're having with the distillery district, is that going to be like a permanent installation or just a temporary exhibition?
No. It's conceptual now, but last summer, a really interesting photographer whose name escapes me, I forget her name, but they featured her artwork on the exterior walls of the distillery for the summer. And it was actually applied as an interesting concept developed by the Toronto Image Works people in Toronto, Eric, who was also responsible for printing a lot of my artwork. He explained the process, but they could not, because it's a historic site, they could not drill into or mount anything to the walls. So what they did is they developed a way of applying the artwork right to the brick. So even though the texture and the relief of the brick interrupted the clean lines of the artwork, it allowed, and we're talking about artwork at sort of 6 feet or 10 by 9. It's just really large format. So I'm hoping, like I said, this is for this interview, it's probably premature to be referring to it, but it's in discussion that maybe my artwork will be a contender for that site to be determined.
Okay, fair enough. But that would be amazing to see, man. Amazing. I'm looking forward to it. I hope it happens.
Well, yeah. I do too. I mean, I reached out the other day. I mean, I met a few times with the people, and there was interest. And I think if I do it in tandem with the Brian, this is an interesting gallery too, because he's very music centric. He shows the artwork of little known people who spend their spare time painting. Probably don't know any of these, but like Paul McCartney or Ronnie Wood from the Stones, Bob Dylan, Mick Fleetwood, Sylvester Stallone, all these people who paint end up showing their artwork in Toronto at that gallery. So I met with Brian and I was delighted that he responded so well to my work. So, when he saw my work, he said, this is great. The rush works great. It'll probably be an interesting draw in terms of bringing people into the gallery. But what I enjoyed about his reaction to my work was that he liked it specifically. He liked my work. So, and not everybody's aware of my work beyond what is published. The record industry makes my work infamous because my clients are famous,
But right.
I'm aware of that infamy being accidental. I don't subscribe to it, but it is what it is. But it hasn't hurt my career to have that. But when Brian said, "Yeah, Rush will be an interesting draw, but I really want to feature your work," so I thought, "Oh, that's a gratifying comment from someone who spends his life in the gallery world."
Yeah, for sure. Well, Hugh, those were the end of my questions, man. Thank you so much for your time.
My pleasure, man. Good evening.
Okay, thank you so much, Hugh. And all the best, man. Thanks. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay, everyone. Thank you for listening. And I hope you enjoyed all of Hugh's insights on so many memorable album covers. Please follow us on Twitter and Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We're going to leave you now with Rush's signature song, Tom Sawyer. Take care and prog on.
A Monday warrior, mean stride. Today's Tom Sawyer, mean pride. Never quite hit the fence. gets high on you, and the space he invades, he gets by.